The discovery of fire, when our species became dominant. When did man begin to control fire? When was he able to produce the first sparks by rubbing two stones together? It is said that this was the invention that determined the intellectual growth of the hominid, that made him what we are today. This was the exclusive discovery of man, the step that other creatures could not take, the essential moment that revolutionized his existence. Without the mastery of fire, human evolution would not have been what it was. Fire provided the decisive input, accelerating and shaping it. It was an essential element to protect oneself from wild animals, to keep warm in the great cold, to cook food, to provide light at night, and to cultivate the soil by facilitating hunting. It was the essential component of the Homo erectus cultural package: fire, shelter, and clothing. But how, where, and when could this discovery, which Darwin described as the most decisive in human history since the development of language, have occurred? In its simplest definition, fire is a process of combustion that manifests itself as light and heat. Its immediate effect is destructive. It disintegrates the highly organized structure of organic matter and reduces it to ash and smoke. This effect is irreversible. The residues can't turn to their original shape and colors. The phoenix rising from its own ashes exists only in the human imagination. Fire has no purpose in and of itself. The process of combustion is blind and does not discriminate. Whatever it touches, if it is of combustible matter, is consumed. By the time the earliest hominids and humans appeared, 3 to 5 million years ago, fires caused by lightning, volcanic eruptions, or other natural causes must have occurred frequently over the entire surface of the land masses. Thus, hominids and humans did not have to go far to discover fire. It is likely that, like any other element, they had to encounter burning vegetation more than once in their lives, and that, like any other primal force, they experienced fire in the same way that they experienced rain and snow, or heat and cold, events that just happened, over which they had no control and to which it was best to adapt. Today we might think that the most important thing our ancestors had to learn was to overcome their fear of fire, but they did not. Like other predators, primitive humans could have benefited from a naturally occurring forest fire. When the fire broke out, they might have seen animals running away. They may have warmed themselves in the heat of the dying embers and collected partially charred animals and fruits from the ashes, finding them distinctly tasty. In this way, they may have learned to appreciate the benefits of cooking, which not only improved the taste of meat, but, more importantly, helped to preserve it and keep it edible even days after. Thus, the first and probably the longest phase of our ancestors' relationship with fire may have been characterized by the use of natural fire whenever the opportunity arose. It has been said that, in this early stage, the use of fire was opportunistic and not yet premeditated. We might also call it mostly passive. To speak of passive use might seem to be an oxymoron, but it helps to distinguish the early stage from the later stage, when hominids began to actively gather and store, and later, to make fire. The ability to control fire was thus a crucial turning point in human evolution, but there is no consensus as to when this ability first developed. Hypotheses based on the evolution of our ancestors' body mass, the size of their molars, and other similar data suggest that the adoption of a diet of cooked foods would be extremely ancient, even dating back to the earliest appearance of Homo erectus, about 1.9 million years ago. Until recently, however, there was no conclusive evidence of a controlled and social use of fire by Homo erectus. In fact, incontrovertible evidence for the use of fire as an integral part of early human life has only been available for sapiens and Neanderthals. Now, analysis by an international team of researchers of a series of traces discovered at the Vondervek cave site in South Africa in a stratigraphic horizon dated to just under 2 million years ago pushes back the earliest evidence of fire use by our ancestors considerably, confirming initial hypotheses. Some preliminary data also indicates that the fuel used at Vondervek consisted mainly of light material, grass and leaves, and probably twigs and small roots. While no residues were found that could be attributed to significant parts of branches or logs. The finding pushes the timeline of fire use back at least 300,000 years, suggesting that some of our distant ancestors, such as Homo erectus, may have begun using fire as an integral part of their way of life. It is likely that Homo erectus learned about fire through naturally occurring fires. Perhaps they first made use of the flame given by the hand of nature and learned to store it for a time, but were unable to provoke it manually. It is conceivable that at a later date, they started the first fires by rubbing, a technique still used today by the bushmen of southern Africa, who use sticks of wood and dried grass. Today, however, the primacy of European fire has passed to a Spanish cave, Cueva Negra, near the city of Murcia. Here, traces of burning date back as far as 800,000 years, a dating proven by the discovery of stone artifacts and burnt animal bones. Chemical and microscopic analysis have shown that these artifacts were exposed to the direct heat of a fire that reached a temperature of between 400 and 600 degrees Celsius. Moreover, the fireplace is located inside the cave, 7 meters from the entrance. In other words, in a protected place. The external environment also does not suggest the possibility of an accidental fire. In fact, Cueva Negra was located in the middle of a swampy area without dry vegetation, on the banks of a river. But were these hearths lit with preserved or freshly generated fire? This is not known. In light of these findings, Homo erectus was still a long way from more advanced ignition techniques based on the use of flint, pyrite particles, and mushrooms. Tools that were instead found much later, in the mid-Neolithic period, on the mummy of Otzi. The Iceman found in the Alps in 1991 carried a birch bark container in which he kept charcoal embers, and in his torn leather pouch was found a dark mass, the remains of a mushroom used to start fires. This tradition of flint use is evidenced in Europe by hundreds of artifacts from 32,000 years ago, when fire had become commonplace and not occasional, but already Homo erectus's bonfires could protect him and his clan from the aggression of ferocious animals, warmed him, provided light in the night, allowed him to store food and cook it, and, a very important factor, stimulated group gathering around the fire. Scholar Polly Wissner of the University of Utah made an interesting survey in this regard. She compared conversations of bushmen recorded during the day with others recorded instead during the night when the community gathered around the fire. While during the day, the bushmen talked mainly about organizational aspects and daily life. Around the fire, their hearts were opened. Imagination reigned. Old people told ancient stories and legends, and young people and children danced and sang. Social and cultural contacts thus had the upper hand. Fire also played an important role in travel, as it enabled early humans to adapt to new environments by providing warmth and protection from predators. Without fire, early humans may have been limited in their ability to migrate and colonize new areas. Numerous animal fat lamps, more than 100 at Lascaux alone, have been found in the French caves of Lascaux and La Motte. Sources of light that illuminated the rocks on which prehistoric artists traced the wonderful paintings dating back 20,000 years. And it is possible that our ancestors also used fire during their hunting parties to direct animals into a space that would facilitate encirclement and thus capture. But we have no definite clues to this effect. Recently, another function of fire has come to light. The techniques of clearing the ground to allow certain types of vegetation to grow and to create wide open spaces to attract certain types of game, thus promoting hunting. Previously, it was thought that burning was the result of the ingenuity of Neolithic man, who developed the cultural package of agriculture and animal husbandry, ushering a new era, the agricultural revolution. By contrast, Paleolithic hunter-gatherers were already using this technology 20,000 years ago. In short, imagining a world without chemical combustion seems very difficult to us, especially since, without this extraordinary element, we would probably not even be here talking about it. As Oscar Wilde wisely said, "What fire does not destroy, it hardens."